Good evening. Good evening, everyone. We are having our lecture series on rheumatology, and today is going to be our third lecture on rheumatology. And the topic for today is an overview on spondyloarthritis. And the speaker for today is Dr. Ruchika Goyal. Ma'am is our associate professor in our department of rheumatology. And if you have any doubts during the session, please put down your doubts in the chat box, and we'll be happy to answer your doubts towards the end of the session. Okay, over to you, ma'am.
Okay, hi. Good evening, everyone. So actually, my topic is overview of spondyloarthropathies. So actually, overview of spondyloarthritis itself is a very big topic. But I try to kind of give you a preface to what we do in, I mean, what do we learn about spondyloarthropathy in our course curriculum. So in whatever we learn in 3 years, I mean, our registrars, I'm going to give you a snapshot of it in 1 hour, okay? You're free to ask questions if you want in between. So, I mean, just don't be mute listeners, okay? All right. So, basically, I would be touching upon a little bit about epidemiology and classification of the disease. Then we'll be talking about just a couple of slides on pathogenesis. And the investigations, which is predominantly imaging in case of spondyloarthropathies, and then treatment and outcome. All right, so treatment, I won't be going in a great deal because it's too much to talk in a lecture. So we'll come to the classification. For those of you who have attended rheumatology postings, clinics, you would have realized that in rheumatology, there is nothing like, you know, one particular diagnostic test to diagnose one particular disease. So everything is based on a combination of different symptoms, signs, and investigations. So that is why we have certain diagnostic criteria and certain classification criteria. So actually, we should not confuse the classification criteria with diagnostic criteria, because classification criteria is basically when we enroll the patients into some particular studies, whereas the diagnostic criteria is like you cannot diagnose a disease without a patient satisfying that particular criteria. For example, your Jones criteria for rheumatic fever, the Kawasaki disease criteria, and so on. So, however, still, it's important to know the classification criteria, because ultimately these are also based on the common clinical findings that we get in our patients. So it just gives us a guide to, you know, whether the patient is having or likely to have some particular heart disease. But definitely these criteria are not to be used in the routine day-to-day clinical practice. So before we go into the criteria per se, we'll just talk about what is spondyloarthropathy. So, you know, it's, I have basically just taken verbatim from the American College of Rheumatology website, where they say it's basically a family of inflammatory. So it's not just a single disease, it's a family of inflammatory rheumatic diseases that is associated with arthritis. So the difference between the other arthritis and spondyloarthropathy is that it involves the sacroiliac joint, and also it involves sites where the ligaments and tendons attach to the bones. So wherever the ligaments and tendons are attaching to the bone, those are the sites which gets inflamed. And in our term, we call them as enthesis. So the arthritis along with enthesitis, that group of disorders basically are generally classified into spondyloarthropathy. Most of them have to have spinal inflammation, but that is actually not the definition as such. So what happened? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay, something happened. Fine. So, and can you see me also?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, okay, fine. So, So when we divide spondyloarthropathies, most of you must have actually learned it. If those people who have read a little bit of rheumatology would have actually read it according to the five types of spondyloarthropathies. So it starts with ankylosing spondylitis, then you have other varieties of spondyloarthropathy, which is basically psoriatic arthritis, reactive arthritis, inflammatory arthropathies associated with inflammatory bowel disease, which is otherwise known as enteropathic arthritis. And if you are satisfied that the patient has spondyloarthropathy, but you cannot classify them into any of these diseases, then you call them as undifferentiated spondyloarthropathy. So what happens is that this was basically, you know, when I started my fellowship, this is how we used to learn. So there are five types of spondyloarthropathies, and these were the spondyloarthropathies. So then later on, one more term is added, which is called as juvenile spondyloarthritis. Okay, so it is in children who are less than 16 years of age. If they have they have features of arthritis and enthesitis plus or minus spinal inflammation, then basically they are called as juvenile spondyloarthritis. But however, now what has happened, the concepts have basically evolved into, rather than naming the disease as disease per se, you look at what are the predominant sites involved, what is the pathophysiology involved, and then you classify the disease according to that. So earlier it used to be, you know, a constellation of certain symptoms and clinical features, and you used to call the disease according to that, and there were some named diseases. But nowadays in rheumatology, in all the diseases, the symptom, the whole, there is a paradigm shift from naming the diseases as such to classifying them according to the organs involved and also the structures involved, and also according to the underlying pathogenesis and pathophysiology, because that is the one which has implication in treatment. So now, the popular classification of spondyloarthropathy is that we divide it into three types. Okay, you have patients presenting with axial symptoms, then you have patients presenting with peripheral symptoms, and the patients who do not present with articular symptoms, but they present with extra-articular manifestations, which we will come in a moment. So patients can have overlap of all these three, or they can present with either two of them or one of them in different permutations and combinations. So then after that, you divide them further. So most of the definitely axial involvement, that's why it is called as ankylosing spondyloarthropathy, spondylitis. Or it can have peripheral involvement, and it can also have extra-articular involvement. But the other inflammatory arthritis, which are considered as in spondyloarthropathy, these basically will have a predominant component of peripheral arthritis, but they also can have axial involvement. So when you look at, so this is another way of classifying the disease. The third way of classification is that you just divide them into two broad categories: axial spondyloarthritis, where you have involvement of spine and sacroiliac joints. Then you have the peripheral spondyloarthropathy, where you have involvement of the large or small small peripheral joints. So in the axial spondyloarthritis, we again can classify them into ankylosing spondylitis, or I'll come to this again, or you have another entity called as non-radiographic axial SPA. So these two will predominantly present with axial symptoms and axial involvement, whereas the peripheral spondyloarthritis are predominantly the ones which present with the peripheral joint involvement. So all the other spondyloarthropathy groups, they present with peripheral predominant spondyloarthritis. So they are called as peripheral spondyloarthritis. They may or may not have axial involvement. Okay, so we'll come to this thing. So as I told you, we have certain classification criteria which guide us towards the diagnosis of disease, but it doesn't mean that we cannot diagnose those patients who present without these criteria into this particular group of condition. So for spondyloarthritis as such, we have something called as European Spondyloarthritis Study Group classification criteria. So in that, basically, you have two components, two stems in the beginning. Either the patient has an inflammatory spinal pain, or the patient has, along with that, patient may have synovitis or asymmetric predominant lower limb arthritis. So synovitis is generally, it is asymmetric and it is predominantly involving the lower limbs. So if the patient presents with these two characteristics, then these two characteristics or either of these two characteristics, then they should also have one or more of the following. So either they should have alternating buttock pain, which basically indicates sacroiliac inflammation. They should have evidence of radiographic sacroiliitis, or they should have a positive family history, or they should have either psoriasis, inflammatory bowel disease, or urethritis, cervicitis, acute diarrhea occurring within 1 month before the onset of arthritis, which is basically the reactive arthritis. So if the patient satisfy these criteria, we can enroll them into any study which is where we are recruiting patients with spondyloarthritis. So that was the spondyloarthritis in general. So after you have classified the patient as spondyloarthropathy, the next thing is that what type of spondyloarthritis. So actually, if you go to the natural evolution of the classification criteria in ACCESS-SPA, it also depends on the natural evolution of the disease. So generally, what happens, the natural course of disease is, initially the patient will have the pre-radiographic stage. Now, pre-radiographic stage means the patient may or may not have back pain, or they may have subtle back pain, and they will have an MRI evidence of active sacroiliitis, but they will not have the X-ray evidence of sacroiliitis. So that is what is called as a pre-radiographic stage. Radiograph here basically is X-ray. So pre-radiographic is that radiographic, there is no evidence, but the patient presents with an inflammatory backache and has active sacroiliitis. Then basically the patient goes on to a radiographic ankylosing spondylitis, where they have back pain, along with that they have radiographic sacroiliitis. And later on, you will go to an advanced stage where the patient starts having, definitely has back pain, but the patient has obvious restriction of movements, that is syndesmotics. So initially, when the axial spondyloarthritis criteria was, axial SPA or ankylosing spondylitis criteria was devised, it basically, what you must be learning into your Davidson and all, that is New York classification criteria, it basically was basically able to pick up the patients at this time, that is back pain along with syndesmophytes. Later on, they were evolved so that the patient comes into this time point. The patient can be diagnosed at this time point. But now, when you talk about the latest classification criteria, which we all follow, that is the ASAS classification criteria, that basically tries to capture the patients at this stage. So ultimately enabling us to treat the patients early. So let's go to those criteria. So see, I'll just give you an example of New York criteria. New York criteria means everywhere you have the limitation of motion in the lumbar spine, then they... Could you please mute yourself? Okay. So there was base. Judy, can you please mute yourself? Or you want to ask something? Hello. Okay. So you have the limitation of motion of the lumbar spine in all the three planes, then history of pain or the presence of pain at dorsolumbus junction or in the lumbar spine, and there is a limitation of chest expansion to 1 inch. All right. So these, if you look at it, these are the characteristics of the advanced anspon, where you start getting limitation because of the syndesmophytes and other features of osteoproliferation. And also, they also needed to have the X-ray evidence of sacroiliitis. So this is basically the radiographic stage, and this basically defines the advanced anspon, basically nowadays what we call as advanced anspon. So then further these criteria modified, and they were now the latest classification criteria which we follow is the SAS criteria of axial spondyloarthropathy, where duration and they will have age of onset to be less than 45 years. So basically young onset back pain, which has certain characteristics, I'll come to that. So that is the entry criteria. So back pain is essential, and the patient should be, the onset of disease should be young onset. Then you basically have two arms. One is you have imaging arm, and the other one is the HLA-B27 arm. So imaging arm basically is that the patient has to have sacroiliitis on imaging and at least one of the spondyloarthropathy features, which are essentially almost same as the ESSG criteria. Or the patient should have HLA-B27 positivity. But if the HLA-B27 is positive and it is not sacroiliitis, then you have to have two or more spondyloarthropathy features. So what are the features? You have inflammatory back pain, you have arthritis, heel pain, that is heel enthesitis, uveitis, or dactylitis, or psoriasis, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis. Along with that, family history of spondyloarthropathy, good response to NSAIDs, HLA-B27 positive, basically if you have an imaging arm in the beginning, elevated CRP concentration, etc. And then there is a definition for sacroiliitis on imaging. I will not come to that in detail at present. So evidence of active inflammation of MRI, highly suggestive of sacroiliitis associated with spondyloarthropathy. Or you should have an X-ray evidence of radiographic sacroiliitis as per the modified New York class criteria. So can I just say, what do you want? Yeah, please take. So then basically, so these are all, you know, classification criteria. When you look at the classification criteria, it is basically you have an established disease and you just want to enroll the patient in one particular study. But when you diagnose the patients with spondyloarthropathy, the items remains the same. But I think this you must have been taught very well in medicine. But you have basically now, you look at the positive criteria and you look at some of the negative test results and then you weigh them. So they are weighted according to the importance. Like for example, radiographic sacroiliitis, it is given the maximum weightage. Presence of HLA-B27 positivity is given a good weightage. Sacroiliitis on MRI is also given a good weightage. If the patient has anterior uveitis and positive family history, it is given a fair weightage and so on and so forth. So you look at the positive test and then you look at the negative test. For example, if HLA-B27 is negative, that is given a high weightage in excluding the diagnosis. And the highest weightage which is given for the negative history is if you have any other likely explanation of the symptom. So if that is there, then that gives actually a very high negative score to a patient being diagnosed as spondyloarthropathy. And so it is beautifully actually in further cartoons, this particular author has very nicely explained how the scale goes to disease being unlikely and disease being highly likely. So this basically depends on the likelihood ratio of each factor contributing to the diagnosis. So in diagnosis, when we talk about diagnosis of spondyloarthropathy, you basically have to go in this scheme rather than just looking at the criteria and trying to satisfy the criteria. So this I'll just skip because it's, so this was all about the classification criteria and the diagnosis of SPA. Are you all with me, whosoever is there? You want me to You want me to decrease my pace or increase my pace?
This is fine, ma'am.
Hello. Somebody speak. So now we go to the clinical features. Okay. So I have been talking for a while about inflammatory back pain, inflammatory back pain. So what is actually inflammatory back pain? So you have different basically criteria, which again, you know, rheumatology is a branch full of criteria. So what we follow currently is the SAS group definition of inflammatory back pain. So a back onset, that 1-5 morning patient started having back pain. And the age of onset, it's a young onset, so less than 40 years. Then you have certain characteristics. That means the pain basically improves with exercises. It doesn't improve with rest. And the pain is predominantly severe at night. So if any of the four characteristics are present, then you call the pain as an inflammatory back pain. So this is a very, very important component of spondyloarthropathy. So inflammatory back pain. Okay, so we should know what is inflammatory back pain. So So the inflammatory back pain, once a patient has inflammatory back pain and the patient has other extra-articular features, then you suppose if you diagnose the patient as spondyloarthropathy. So actually, as I told you, in SAS criteria, what it starts with a patient coming with back pain. All right. So when the patient comes with back pain, what you basically do is what this diagram gives you, and it is a very beautiful diagram because that gives you a scheme of diagnosis as well as a progression of disease. So first you try to figure out whether the patient has an inflammatory back pain. So let's say out of in an OPD, which deals only with back pain, out of 100 patients, approximately you may have 10 patients who come with inflammatory back pain. So then you have to look at whether the patient has any genetical predisposition. So that is basically what I'm talking is the HLA-B27 positivity. So once the patient has any of these things, next thing what you look at is that earlier you used to look at X-ray. So basically you used to discuss about whether the patient has a here radiographic sacroiliitis or not. But now we basically want to pick up the patient at this stage. So what do we do? We do an MRI to see whether the patient has a non-radiographic evidence of axial spondyloarthropathy in the form of sacroiliitis in MRI, which is not there in X-ray. If you have X-ray evidence, you don't have to do MRI. So what happens to these patients? These patients have a very minority of them going into spontaneous remission. In the sense, they are not going to progress further and they will become asymptomatic. All right. So this is the spontaneous remission. But a majority of them from non-radiographic axial SPA will go on to the next stage. Next stage is basically what? Some of them will go into spontaneous remission. A sizable proportion may go into a quiescent disease activity. Means they will not have any evidence disease activity, but because of certain syndesmophytes which have already formed, they will have a mild restriction, but it will not be active. All right. But majority of them, what will happen? Either a proportion of them, let's say around 40%, will still remain non-radiographic axial SPA. In the sense, they will have symptoms, they will have MRI evidence of sacroiliitis, but they will not have a X-ray manifestation of sacroiliac joint involvement. So that is the non-radiographic axial SPA. So 40% of them will remain like this, whereas around 60% of them will actually go into proper ankylosing spondylitis, which you can diagnose by the ASAS criteria for axial spondyloarthritis. Okay. Out of the patient, many of them who may progress and develop late complications, which I'll just come to, or a minimal proportion of patients will have a non-progressive ankylosing spondylitis. That means they will stay at what they are. All right. So these are the various ways which basically, these are the various stages at which you come across the patient. And now in rheumatology, our idea is to identify the patients at this level. So this is basically what I want to say. When I am sure you all know Professor Devishish Danda. So when he probably must be doing his training, this was the place at which they used to diagnose the patient. This was the condition. All kyphotic, severe severe ankylosis of the spine, and what you must have learned, classical bamboo spine and, you know, fixed spine and all sorts of things. So, but this is not the case. So when I started, I must say, when I started my training, we used to see patients, most of the patients used to come in this condition. That means they used to have evidence of deformity, and they used to have severe ankylosis, but they were not at this stage. Okay, they were not coming with this kind of deformity. But now the registrars who are seeing, they are seeing most of the patients either at this stage. That means you have a slight disappearance of lumbar lordosis and you don't have too much of deformities, or they will just encounter the patients who have just inflammatory backache and will not have any other features. They may have certain other features, like this is basically a typical large joint inflammatory arthritis in peripheral spondyloarthritis, or the patients can present with pain and or swelling of Achilles tendons insertion, indicating the Achilles tendon enthesitis. Or they can also present with symptoms suggestive of psoriasis, skin involvement psoriasis, or they can present with what is called as dactylitis. What is dactylitis? Dactylitis is basically the combination of synovitis along with the soft tissue inflammation around the joint as well as extending beyond the joint. So it is basically synovitis along with evidence of soft tissue inflammation. Is tenosynovitis along with involvement of the soft tissue. Inflammation of soft tissue is basically dactylitis. So the patient would have like bulbous finger. You can see this is the bulbous finger. Along with this patient has some evidence of DIP arthritis. So this is a characteristic example of psoriatic arthritis. So these are the various clinical features that we see in our routine clinics nowadays. And we don't see the classical Angspond picture, which I showed you in the previous slide. This is another example. This has been contributed by our registrar, Dr. Pratyusha. So you can see basically the patient, this is our CMC patient who had presented just with Achilles tendonitis. So this is basically the tenosynovitis of the Achilles tendon at the site of insertion, which is at the calcaneum. So, or the patient can present with plantar fasciitis, plant inflammation of the plantar fascia. So a patient can just present with plantar fasciitis. So apart from the joint, the patients sometimes will also have extra articular involvement. So I've just put up this table because it nicely synopsizes. Patients can present with conjunctivitis. This is usual presentation, what happens in reactive arthritis. Or the patients can present with anterior uveitis, which can be symptomatic or which may not be symptomatic. So in the anterior uveitis, so basically the patient will have features of congestion of eye, photophobia, they will have pain, and they will have increased watering from the eye. And then when you send them to ophthal, they will have generally anterior uveitis, and anterior uveitis can be alternating. It may involve both the eyes, it may involve one eye. The prevalence of anterior uveitis is around 23% in Angspond, 16% in non-radiographic Angspond. The second thing is the inflammatory bowel disease. Now in the inflammatory bowel disease, basically, So inflammatory bowel disease, it also, generally they will not have common features, you know, classical features of Crohn's or ulcerative colitis, but they can have undifferentiated colitis, which may not fit into either of these two defined IBD entities. So the prevalence of inflammatory bowel disease is generally around 6% in ANSPON and around 4% in non-radiographic axial SPA. Or the patients, as I've already discussed, can present with, the frequency or the prevalence of peripheral inflammatory arthritis is seen, it is seen in up to 30% of patients with ANSPON and the similar percentage of patients in non-radiographic axial SPA. However, the incidence of peripheral inflammatory arthritis in other arthritis, that is psoriatic arthritis, enteropathic arthritis, juvenile ANSPON, juvenile spondyloarthropathy, and reactive arthritis is much more than 30%. Then you have it, the dactylitis, the prevalence is basically, it can be seen on the fingers as well as toe inflammation. So it is also seen the same similar percentage as IBD, so around 6% of ANSPON patients and non-radiographic SPA. The enthesitis, which I just presented, it can be ankylosing tendonitis, plantar fasciitis. It is again as common as peripheral arthritis, so it is seen in around 30% of the patients. In non-radiographic axial SPA, it is seen in a little higher proportion of patients. Or as in case of reactive arthritis, the patient can have evidence of non-gonococcal urethral inflammation. And aortitis can be seen in some patients. I have read a lot, but I actually have seen only in one patient who had a juvenile onset spondyloarthropathy. Okay, so they will have inflammation of aortic root and ascending aorta, and they will commonly present with aortic regurgitation. So never forget to auscultate a patient, especially with juvenile spondyloarthropathy, to see for the murmur of AR. Then skin psoriasis is generally seen in around 10% of the patients, both in radiographic as well as in non-radiographic SPA. So actually, earlier you must have read, no? Classically, it's a diagnosis which is generally received by males. But actually now, as more and more non-radiographic SPA is being diagnosed, the prevalence of SPA in females is also increasing, and it is now the gender difference is not as much as what we used to learn earlier. So females generally present with more pain. They will have more of these extra articular features, for example enthesitis, inflammatory bowel disease, psoriasis, peripheral arthritis. They are more likely to have osteoporosis. Then they will have higher disease activity scores, but the functional disability will not be so much as what we see in males. So they are less compliant to treatment. So that is why they keep switching drugs more as compared to males. Even if the burden of inflammatory markers in the form of CRP inflammation, in the form of ESR, CRP levels is actually more in males. So the disease, they present with more disease activity, more pain, less responsive to treatment, more of peripheral extra-articular symptoms, but lesser increase in inflammatory markers, and the true disease activity scores will be high, but the limitation in the form of BASMI will be low in females. So now, after you have looked at all the clinical features, the next thing we still look at is radiography. Okay, so this you can see the play. Basically, earlier the teaching was that you look at sacroiliac joint oblique view, but now the radiologists are more and more getting convinced that peripheral just a pelvis X-ray may be enough for to diagnose a clinically evident sacroiliitis. So you can, the radiographs, they are graded according to the changes in at the sacroiliac joint. So this is a sacroiliac joint. So what you can see here is basically the sacroiliac joint is completely obliterated. It's not completely obliterated. You can see some evidence of joint here, but most of it is obliterated. Most of it is fused. So this is a grade 3 sacroiliitis. Whereas in this also, it is grade 3 sacroiliitis. Suppose if I had not seen this line, And it, then you could have called it as grade 4 sacroiliitis, means completely ankylosed. Apart from this, you also have to look at these, the sites of enthesis insertion. For example, you can, you have to look at greater tuberosity, you have to look at the greater trochanter, and wherever the tendons insert. And what do you get there? You get evidence of enthesitis in the form of irregularity of the bone, extra bone formation, and sometimes, very rarely, the soft tissue inflammation. So these are the features which you get in the pelvis x-ray of the patients having spondyloarthropathy. But as I told you, sometimes the patients may present with absolutely normal pelvic x-ray. So then what do you do? So in that case, basically, you are talking, what you're talking about is a non-radiographic SPA. So you basically, most of the patients nowadays end up in getting MRI, because nowadays patients are getting referred much, much more earlier as compared to previous olden times. Just a minute. I am taking a class. Please wait. So in that case, basically you have, what you do is the MRI of sacroiliac joint. So what you get in MRI of sacroiliac joint, the first thing is basically what you have to look at is the stir images, where you get evidence of bone marrow edema in the form of this hyper intense lesions, what you can see. So this is basically the bone marrow edema. Then in the T1 weighted images, what you see is basically evidence of erosion at the sacroiliac joint. The rest of the things you don't need to bother in this thing. It is more important for our patients, our registrars as compared to your guys. So if you get this kind of bone marrow edema, then it is, you at least will have a suspicion of active sacroiliitis. However, I'm sorry, I couldn't insert that picture here, but suppose if you get along with this, if you get just one-sided inflammation of this sacroiliac joint, and you get a lot of soft tissue shadow, then a lot of soft tissue inflammation, in the sense a lot of hyperintensity here, there will be some capsulitis, the inflammation of the capsule, which is seen here. You can see this bright line, so this is inflammation of the capsule. So you see capsulitis, and along with that, you get a lot of soft tissue inflammation, and asymmetrical sacroiliitis, only one sacroiliac joint involved, then you should also think of ruling out two things. One is you should definitely rule out tuberculosis and other joint infection, as well as in some cases, especially in older females and all, you also can have, if there is a lot of bone marrow edema, you also can have, sometimes the stress fractures can also present like this. So I think it is better to leave it to the radiologist or the rheumatologist to read the MRI. However, if you have images like this, then definitely you should think of spondyloarthropathy. So this is, as I was saying, this is a T1 image here. Actually, if you can look at this sacroiliac joint, it is a very nicely defined sacroiliac joint. But here, if you see, there you can see actually some of the sacroiliac joint is, the joint space is reduced, and along with that, you have evidence of erosion. Okay, in this, the erosion is very much clear because you can see an irregular joint line. This is indicative of definite erosion. All right, so this is basically the T1 image. So other than the sacroiliac joint inflammation, what you also look at, you look at the spine. Now, gone are the days when you used to see bamboo spine. That is not what we see now. At the most, what we can see is that some of the places you can see syndesmopyte, as you can see here, or what we get is the corner lesions. Corner lesions are basically the bone marrow edema along with the fat metaplasia at the vertebral corner. So anterior corner lesions are more common as compared to the posterior corner lesions. How do you see them in MRI? So what you see in T1 weighted image is because it's inflammation, you go straight to T2 weighted images. So what do you get in T2 weighted images? You get this hyper intensity of the corners. So this is basically what is called as Romano's sign, or basically anterior corner lesions of the spine. So these are the inflammatory lesions which you see in the spine. This is also one inflammatory spinal lesion. Okay. Sometimes you can also get features of discitis. Actually, we call it as Anderson's discitis, but sometimes you should understand. So this is not an infective discitis. If you have these anterior spinal lesions along with this kind of a discal inflammation, then you think of, there's something called as Anderson's discitis, which we can see in spondyloarthropathy. So after you have looked at radiology, you have looked at x-rays, you have looked at, inflammatory markers, and you are very clear on your history, examination and all. So what is the next thing? The next thing is basically you have to figure out how active is the patient. So we have certain objective scores which we follow just to objectivize, you know, today, because in the OPD, it is possible that, you know, the same patient may not be seen by the same doctor over time. But if you have scored the patient, it is very easy to follow up the disease activity. All right. So we have a set of scores. The most popular score which is followed now is basically put forward by this Assessment of Spondyloarthritis International Society group. It's called as ASTAS. So ASTAS basically takes into account what? It takes into account back pain on a scale. So it's a, there's a visual analog scale. We ask the patient, how is your back pain? How severe is your back pain? And the patient is supposed to mark it on a scale of 0 to 10. The same way, we ask the patient, what is the morning stiffness? What is the duration? And we have different scores for any stiffness less than half an hour. Well, half an hour to 1 hour, 1 to 1.5 hours, 2 hours, and more than that. So scores are basically given according to that. Then you have the patient global assessment. How much is his disease as such? So that's a global assessment. Then you go to the peripheral. So you have peripheral pain or swelling. Again, it is scored by the patient 0 to 10. And then you look at the inflammatory marker, which is ESR and CRP. Now you should know, see, this is basically the scoring. If you look at it, the maximum weightage is actually given to the inflammatory markers, which is followed by the back pain and the peripheral arthritis. And then you can calculate the disease activity score. So if the score is less than 1.3, we say that the patient is fine, patient doesn't have an active disease. If you get a score between 1.3 and 2.1, you call it as moderate disease activity. More than 2.1, but less 3.5, it's high disease activity. Anything above 3.5 is considered as very high disease activity. Now, why do you need it? Because you need to change therapy according to the disease activity scores. So it is very important in Western countries because, you know, for everything, for giving biologics to the patient, they have to justify that the patient requires biologics because state sponsors it. So that is why they have to do these scorings mandatory. So what is a clinically important improvement? If the patient has a reduction of in this ASTAS score of more than or equal to 1.1 points, then you call it as a clinically important improvement. Clinically important improvement will be perceived by patient as improvement. Anything less than that will not be perceived by patient as improvement. And what is a major improvement which we are targeting by giving biologics is basically a change, that means a decrease of score by at least 2 points or more. Now, conventionally we used to follow and still we follow is BASTI. So this is again a patient driven score where we have a set of 6 questions. And again, we ask the patient to score like this and we calculate the score. If the BASTI score is less than or equal to 3.8, this is inactive. Anything, any score between 3.8 and 5.2, it is moderate. This is activity high, this is activity above it. Now for patient, for us to call it as a major improvement, you should have a change of at least 4 scores to call it as a major improvement. Now, after we have looked at the clinical features, the diagnosis and disease activity assessment, I thought it is now better to put the etiopathogenesis slide rather than putting it in the beginning and bore you people like anything. So about the etiopathogenesis, you know, can somebody tell me what is an innate immune response and a adaptive immune response? In the era of COVID, it will be very easy, no? anybody other than Nitin can switch, unmute yourself and just tell. Hello. Nobody's there in the class, Nitin?
I'm there, ma'am. Around 29 are there.
Okay, so one of you. Who is Judy? She was the. Sorry. No one is there.
Sakshi, would you like to take the question?
Innate immunity is what we are born with, so it's mostly like a T cell mediated immunity, or our body is producing like a immunity will be antibody mediated immunity, like immunoglobulins mediated immunity.
Anybody else wants to correct? I will not go to the pathogenesis without this. Let me see some names then. Abhinav Agarwal, who is that?
Good evening, ma'am.
All the rheumatology posting. Yeah, Abhinav.
Ma'am, innate immunity is
what is innate immune response? What is?
Ma'am, innate.
Do you agree with Sakshi?
Innate is what the patient is born with, ma'am. And adaptive is what is acquired following an infection, which is basically as a response to.
That is
to
the layman language.
Innate would include our mucosal barrier.
Okay, fine. No, it's not like this. Fine. Innate immune responses, as you said, the patient, the generally, we're born with an innate immune response, but immediately as we are born, we have enough of adaptive immunity as well. But the difference between innate immune responses, innate immune responses is the immediate response. What you get after, let's say, I'll give you an example of COVID only. So what you get initially, you have a deficiency of innate immune response. Okay, so the body is not able to clear the virus. Then you get a lot of inflammation, because that is innate immune response. The innate immune response is predominantly propagated by and mediated by the innate immune cells, like you have all the myeloid cells, neutrophils, basophils, macrophage, and along with that, macrophages, mast cells, all right, and there are some other NK cells. So this is basically, these are the cells which are involved in bringing up innate immune response. So they are immediate immune response, and with some exceptions, the innate immune response doesn't have a memory. Okay, classically it doesn't have a memory, and it is very, very, it is just, you know, it is not specific. Okay, it is not like, let's say, it's not a viral specific immunity. The response which you get in COVID, the same kind of innate response you can get in when you're infected with any other virus. So that is the innate immune response. It is broad. It is broad, and it is basically directed against certain evolutionary conserved antigens. No, not antigens, actually, evolutionary conserved proteins. Evolutionary conserved proteins, okay? But adaptive immunity is basically, as we said, it's a learned acquired immunity. It is basically mediated by T cells and B cells. Okay, so mediated the humoral immunity. Anywhere there in innate immune responses. Okay, so these are very specific immune responses. Means the T cell, one particular T cell will be able to react with a set of peptides only. So that means it is antigen specific. That is why it is acquired. when you get infections and you get a memory. So what you give in vaccine, like for example, when you vaccinate a patient, you're basically eyeing to develop the adaptive immunity. Innate immunity is the inherent capacity, immediate ability to fight the infections. Are you guys clear? This is MBBS third year lectures. I think I should not go to pathogenesis then at all. Basically, the spondyloarthropathy, initially everything was autoimmune. Okay, then when the innate immunity concept came, then actually people started thinking that spondyloarthropathy is actually an autoimmune disease. Other autoimmune diseases are like Behçet's disease, periodic liver syndromes, gout, psoriasis, IBD. So these are autoimmune diseases which are basically mediated by the innate immune system. Then later on, people started thinking, there is some involvement of T cells as well. You have some antigen specific T cells as well as a little bit of humoral, B cells, evidence of humoral immunity, which suggests that the patient that there is a component of autoimmune, adaptive immune abnormality also in patients with spondyloarthropathy. This adaptive immune abnormality is seen more in females. Okay, so the females have more preponderance of adaptive immune abnormality as compared to males. So this is I think I'll skip this because if you are not clear on innate and adaptive immunity, there's no point in talking about this. Let's skip. No. All right. So I'll just come to this. Let's skip the pathogenesis. I'll just tell you this one. All right. So when a patient comes, you have a certain genetic predisposition as well as some what you call epidemiological demographic predisposition. So if let's say the patient is young, then HLA-B27, you all must have heard. So if HLA-B27 is positive, there are other genes, other SNPs and other genes which are also involved. But the most popular and which has got the involvement in causality of diseases, HLA-B27. So HLA-B27, the positivity for HLA-B27, along with some changes in the inherent microbiome, for example, in the gut microbiome, skin microbiome, etc., and mechanical stress. So these are basically the risk factor which predispose to development of spondyloarthropathy. That is why what you will find is, you will find that quite a lot of young males especially, they come, they had a fall. And then the next, after 10 days, they started developing all the symptoms. So that is basically because of mechanical stress. And this mechanical stress has a significant role in causing NTCL inflammation. So these are the risk factors. Then when the patient has risk factor and then you have certain other triggers, what happens is that there is an activation of innate immune responses. So innate immune responses are mediated basically neutrophils, myeloid cells, other myeloid cells, and there are something called as innate lymphocytes. So all of them basically, they release a lot of pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines, the most important being TNF and interleukin 23. So interleukin 23 and TNF, these are the, when these are increased, then what happens, interleukin 23 basically causes activation of certain other cells like gamma delta T cells, CD4 T cells, and some unknown cells, which ultimately results in production of phages, secretion of interleukin 17 as the main site. These two actually, TNF, interleukin 17, along with interleukin 6, interleukin 23, they cause for inflammation in the entheses as well as in the peripheral joints. Okay. Then what happens? Once the enthesis and peripheral joint inflammation, it goes on further, in spondyloarthropathy, you start getting complications. What is a complication? You start getting bone marrow edema because of all these things. Bone marrow edema ultimately culminates in the bone marrow manifest inflammation, which is known as osteitis. This osteitis heals with newborn formation. And when you have a lot of newborn formation, what you get is the fusion of the vertebral bodies. So this is basically, in short, the pathogenesis of spondyloarthropathy. This also, okay. Now I just wanted to bring in this very important thing. What about pain? Pain in spondyloarthropathy is, other than the inflammation of the spine, you also get pain because of because when you have inflammation, you have erosions, you can also, you also have a lot of osteoproliferation, and these two things are major changes in the spine. So you will find that a lot of, there are few patients who won't have a complete relief even after taking the best of the treatment. Pain is also contributed by these individuals. And also, especially in females, there is a definite evidence to suggest that there is a neuropathic component also, which because hyperalgesia. So these are the patients who probably would require other pharmacotherapy, which I will not come to in detail. Or they also may require certain, you know, certain, like for example, pregabalin or certain agents which help in the neuropathic pain sometimes. So these are the components of pain. So it is very important to, you know, dissect out what kind of pain the patient has rather than just be happy by giving anti-inflammatory agents. Now we'll come to, what's the time? Oh, I think I've, can I just take 5 more minutes, Nitin?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So now, as I told you, okay. So the principles of management I'll come to in the next slide. But, you know, I want you to know what is this non-radiographic axial spa, because now more and more patients are coming with non-radiographic axial spa. Their sacroiliac joint will be absolutely normal, but they will have a lot of articular and extra-articular symptoms, especially the younger patients, the females, you know, so they will be presenting with these kind of features. But the sacroiliac joint extra will be normal. Please don't leave them like that. If you are convinced that the pain is inflammatory, a young lady has some extra-articular features like uveitis or peripheralitis, because the patients may be having non-radiographic spa. And the implication is that if otherwise you would diagnose the patient as seronegative RA, which is not correct. Because these patients respond very beautifully to most of the, except for infliximab, which is not approved for treatment of non-radiographic axial spa. Otherwise, all the TNF, anti-TNF agents, as well as I-17 blockers, they help these patients who are presenting with non-radiographic axial spa. So that is the improvement in knowing this entity called non-radiographic axial spa. The projection is that by 2040, you would hardly see the non-radiographic axial spa. This I'll just skip. Okay, just to know that, you know, 8% of the patients with non-radiographic axial spa at baseline, they progress to radiographic axial spa. A lot of patients actually remain as non-radiographic axial spa with or without treatment. So we should know that, only a minimal proportion of patients actually progress to radiographic axial spa. So then there is another entity now, which is Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
When did I get muted on this slide only?
Yes, just now, ma'am. The slides are not visible.
Just now. Oh. You're not able to see my slides?
No, no, ma'am.
Since when?
Just now.
Okay, let me share it again. What about now?
It's loading, man. Yeah, it's visible, man.
No.
Yes, it's visible, man. Slides are there.
Okay. All right. Sure. All right. So the peripheral spa basically, and it is basically, it starts with peripheral arthritis and or enthesitis and or dactylitis along with any of the spondyloarthropathy feature. Okay. So any of these features are there, then you can call it as peripheral spa. Now peripheral spa, the problem is that the patients, like, they will have asymmetric arthritis, they will have predominantly large joint arthritis, or they will have some extra articular manifestation, or they may just have inflammatory back pain, but they'll not have any other axial symptoms. So these are the patients who are basically, you would have thought of seronegative arthritis. So these patients, peripheral arthritis and or enthesitis along with dactylitis and with one of the spinal spondyloarthropathy features, like extra articular features, or two of the spondyloarthropathy features, which includes arthritis, enthesitis, dactylitis, inflammatory back pain, or a family history of SPA. So basically, why should we know peripheral SPA? Now, peripheral SPA, basically, there are specific trials, actually, which have looked at peripheral SPA and the efficacy of different biologics. So they generally say, like, if you have a peripheral SPA, the TNF blockers are definitely the drug of choice. But this interleukin 12, 23 inhibitors, for the classic example, ustekinumab. So that is sometimes not so very beneficial in axial SPA or in axial SPA. It may be beneficial in polyarticular spondyloarthropathy, psoriatic spondyloarthropathy, but it is these interleukin 17 blockers as well as the interleukin 12, 23 blockers, JAK inhibitors, phosphodiesterase 4 inhibitors, these are not so very good in, I mean, they are not so very efficacious in peripheral spondyloarthropathy. So if a patient presents with peripheral spondyloarthropathy, basically TNF, anti-TNFs as of now are the drug of choice. You have to also differentiate peripheral spondyloarthropathy from polyarticular psoriatic spondyloarthropathy. So you have to look at things like nail pittings, psoriatic changes, hidden sites of psoriasis, or evidence of anterior uveitis, which is very common in psoriatic spondyloarthropathy. Peripheral SPA from polyarticular psoriatic spondyloarthropathy, which also presents with peripheral inflammatory arthritis, because the management is a little different. Why are my slides not moving? Okay. Now, just one slide on management, three slides on management. So basically, before I go to management, I thought it is important for you to have an idea of the disease activity assessment other than ASTAS. ASTAS is a comprehensive disease activity assessment. But there are certain things which you should know. If you want to check for function, how is the functional ability or disability of the functional capacity of the patient? Then you have a score which is known as BASPI. I will not go into detail. It is back ankylosing spondylitis functional index, which basically looks at the functional aspect of functionality of the patient. You should also assess what is the pain. So basically, how was the illness because of peripheral arthritis? Then you look at the restriction. Okay, this the limitation of mobility. So in that, predominantly you have to look at chest expansion, because if the patient has had costochondral enthesitis and further osteoporosis, spinal flexion in the form of modified Schober's test, then also you will have to look at the cervical spine. So the two indicators are, one is you do something called as occipital wall distance, and then cervical rotation. And then you look at the lateral spinal flexion. So all these scores come, all these things, items come under a score which is known as BASMI. Okay, so it's a meteorology index. So it is BASMI. Then you also look at what is the patient's global assessment of the disease as such, as compared to the last one. Then you assess what is the morning stiffness which the patient has. And then the last thing is fatigue. How is the fatigue? So all these things actually have to be looked at in a regular OPD in some or the other way to get a comprehensive assessment of the disease. This is predominantly, actually, I'll just take a minute because I think few of our registrars may also be there in this. So these are actually in daily practice. This is basically put forth by, again, European League Against Rheumatism. So you have certain patients, as I told, you have BASDAI, VAS, ASDAS, fatigue. So the most important patient reported outcome, which is mandatory, is whether the patient has, how severe is the nocturnal back pain and how severe is the morning stiffness. That is the most. Then next thing is the patient's global VAS and ASDAS. Okay. Then after that, the next important things are what is discussed, what is written in this slide, blue and sky blue circles. Then you look at the physician's interview. So when you look, when you ask, the most important things what you should ask is that history of psoriasis, history of IBD, history of Ruvia. Look for any history of heart failure, like dyspnea mellitus. All right. Next is history of kidney involvement, which is also important in making, in channelizing the treatment. Then in the physical examination, something which is very useful is basically you look at the coxofemoral rotation, that is basically the hip joint rotation. You look at the swollen point joint count, and also you look at the spinal mobility in the form of modified Schober's. The rest all things are potentially useful, but at least this much should be looked at in patients with axial spur. In extra-articular manifestations, the most important thing is the CRP. CRP and also urinary examination, because some patients may present with something called as IgA nephropathy. So urine test strip actually gives us a quantification of proteinuria, at least a qualitative analysis of proteinuria. The rest all things are may or may not be so very useful. In the structural evaluation, basically what you are looking at is the sacroiliac joint radiographs, and the next best is the spinal radiographs. The other things, this is basically the core set items which you should try to collect during the regular OPD visits of the patient for a comprehensive assessment of the disease status. Now coming to the management, you have non-pharmacological management in the form of exercise. So you have to give a prescription of aerobic exercise, flexibility exercises, resistance, that is strength improvement exercises, and also neuromotor exercises. So the example of flexibility exercises, like for example, you have hydrotherapy, you have stretching exercises. So these two basically comprise the flexibility exercises. So there are different exercise programs. I'll not come into that. But however, exercise has definitely been shown to improve the functional scores. And there is a study which also shows that it improves the activity score also in patients. What about the pharmacological management? So this is the last slide. So in pharmacological management, if the patient presence of Angspond presents to you, what will you do? You have to first determine the disease activity. Disease activity active, that means your different scores like ASDAS score of more than 1.3, like that. So then first you try NSAIDs. Continuous NSAIDs are preferred. Then you ask the patient to do physical therapy. Active therapy is better over passive therapy. The land-based therapies are better over aquatic therapy. You advise the patient against systemic glucocorticoid steroids. Please, a lot of patients, especially from the Eastern India, they come with this, they come pumped with the systemic glucocorticoid steroids. Please advise them against it. Then also look at whether the patient has peripheral arthritis. Peripheral arthritis, if it is just like some two or more large joints, you can give local glucocorticoid steroids. And along with that, you can give sulfasalazine. Sulfasalazine is preferred over methotrexate in peripheral arthritis of patients with spondyloarthritis. Okay, and how do I get over this talking? Just a minute. Okay, so and you advise the patient against any other therapy like leflunomide, apremilast, thalidomide, and palmitoneic pulse. All these things were used earlier. If the patient has isolated secretolytic enthesitis, you can use NSAIDs. And if the patient, despite NSAIDs, has this thing, you can try local glucocorticoid injection. But you should not try Achilles, patellar, or cordyceps enthesis glucocorticoid injection. Earlier people used to try, now it's absolute no-no. Okay. Then the second line therapy, that means you assess the patient at 3 months. If the patient is not good, then you straight away go to biologics. So earlier TNF inhibitors were preferred over IL-17 inhibitors, but now IL-17 inhibitors also slowly are coming as the first line pharmacological therapy in these patients. My slides again must not be visible, right?
Yeah, just now got off now.
Shall I continue or you are bored?
We can continue, ma'am. Management part.
Yeah, it's just 2 slides only. As you said, I have not put too many slides on the management. Are some people still there?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, now you can see, no?
Yes.
Okay, so, but you have certain extra-articular manifestations. For example, if you have uveitis, then monoclonal antibodies are preferred over the receptor blockers. So in inflammatory bowel disease also, monoclonal antibodies are preferred as compared to the receptor blockers. So if the patient still is active in spite of this, then what do you do? Then you go to another biologic. So if you're giving TNF blocker, you go to IL-17 blockers, to tofacitinib. Okay, but do not try the same TNF blocker. Now you have biosimilar. For example, I'll give you example is like adalimumab. So if you're trying Exemptia now, you don't go and try something else like Adefrar or something, because that particular same group of TNF blocker you can't give. You have to try either alternative TNF blocker. For example, if you're giving adalimumab, you can try golimumab, or if you're giving adalimumab, you can try etanercept, or you go on to another group to, for example, IL-17 blockers, IL-12, 23 blockers, etc. So this is the general thing. Okay. Still, if the patient is not feeling and the patient is not getting so very better on biology, please repeat the spinal or pelvis MRI to see is there any other cause of the pain. Okay. You are not going to target a score of more than 1.3 or 2.1. That is not. What you basically have to look at is whether the patient is okay. You know, the patient's global assessment is good. So that is what generally treat to target as of now is not the norm in spondyloarthropathy. It may come in future. If the patient, what if their BASTI is, let's say, 1, that means it's not active, okay, then what do you do? Stable. Then you just give on-demand NSAID and you give physical therapy. So if your disease activity scores are suggestive of stable disease, just physical therapy and on-demand NSAIDs. And do not, and look at additional manifestations. If patient has severe kyphosis or if the patient has advanced hip arthritis, so if you have advanced hip arthritis, you can go for the replacement. But if the patient has severe kyphosis, just don't go for things like spinal osteotomy and things like that. It is not going to improve the quality of life of patient. If the patient has spinal fusion or advanced osteoporosis, you just treat osteoporosis, give them physical therapy, just don't do any kind of spinal manipulation. Don't refer the patient for all that. It used to be done earlier, now it's not advised. Stable patient on biologics, you don't discontinue. As of now, we try tapering, but I'm not sure that this particular thing actually doesn't support tapering. But there are trials now, there they have looked at that you can't withdraw, but you can always decrease the dose or increase the interval. If the patient is on TNF and NSAID, you can stop NSAIDs, continue on TNF alone. If the patient is stable on TNF and oral small molecules, just continue TNF inhibitors. Do not give oral small molecules, for example, tofacitinib. If the patient is stable AS on TNF inhibitors, then, we don't know. Basically, we try to taper it. But stopping is something which nowadays we also do not advise. This is actually not my slide. This is basically from Taiwan. But we follow almost the same thing. So I thought this is a good diagram to show you in OPDs. What we do, we educate the patient, social support, regular exercises, we tell them to quit smoking, we also tell them to reduce weight if they are obese and avoid the contact sports and all, which is likely to cause trauma. We give them NSAIDs, we generally give them acyclofenac, so for the persistent pain and high CRP, and we also try them on conventional synthetic DMARDs like sulfasalazine for peripheral arthritis. We also give methotrexate because our patients do respond to it. Then if they are not better, we give biologics. Okay, and we start with TNF blockers. If they are not responding, we change the TNF blocker to a different group. If that is not responding, then we consider these therapies like IL-17 inhibitors. Some patients may be on small molecules also, small oral molecules. Alternative and experimental therapies, we don't do. We don't try. So this is what is the scheme which is followed in rheumatology department here. And that's it. I am done, Nitin. I am happy to take questions if you wish to ask. I know I have taken 20 minutes extra.
Got it. If you have any doubts, please can either ask a question right now or can put it down in the chat box. Regarding the management, once they have gone to the TNF blocker stage, should we have to continue the conventional DMARDs or should we stop completely?
No. Conventional DMARDs are basically not continued as a therapy, it is basically continued. Methotrexate is continued because methotrexate is supposed to it basically develops antibodies against these molecules because they are proteins. So what we do is we basically give methotrexate to prevent that antibody formation. So that is why on TNFIs and all we give methotrexate. However, in spondyloarthropathy, there is data to suggest you can give simple TNF inhibitors without giving any other agents. All right, without giving conventional synthetic DMARDs. But if we generally prefer to give it. However, if you're giving receptor blockers like etanercept, sometimes golimumab, these have less antigenicity. So these can be given as a standalone drugs.
And oral steroids are contraindicated, ma'am?
Absolute no. If the patient has severe peripheral arthritis involving multiple joints, you can try a little bit as a bridge therapy, but that too not more than a month. You know, it all depends on your stage. But as such, in spondyloarthropathy, in peripheral arthritis due to spondyloarthropathy, in enthesitis, dactylitis, you're not supposed to give oral steroids. You can give local intra-articular injections wherever you want. These people are there or not there?
Yeah, they are there, man.
My computer may go off at any point of time. My battery is absolutely low. Or they have, because I really don't think the medicine PGs, they don't know what is the difference between innate and adaptive immune system. And then still they don't attend. Where are all of them? I will write to Tambu sir. Where are all of them? Who is that? Tarun, Dr. Tarun S. You there? See, Nitin, I told you. Dr. Thomas Philip, are you there? Okay, this goes to Tambu sir. Okay? Sure. Okay then.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much.
You guys should give a feedback to your HODs and tell them, discontinue the classes because we are not interested.
Thank
okay
you,
then, Nitin. I hope it was helpful for those people who are there.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thanks. Bye.